MA Korumbakkam branch is proud to have a lot of orations every month. And this month we are privileged to have two. I request Dr. Edwin Fernando to come onto the dais to give the first oration of Dr. N.K. Srinivasan. About N.K. Srinivasan, the chairperson is Dr. Sridhar and Dr. Balakrishnan take the dais. So please be seated, sir. I request Dr. Sridhar to say a few words about Dr. N.K. Srinivasan.
Dr. N.K. Srinivasan was born on 29th of July 1927. His qualification is MBBS, FCGP India, and FRSH London. He was born in Guntur Government Hospital, Andhra Pradesh. Family details. He was the last among five children, native of Tamil district. Personal. Eldest daughter was social work oriented, trained herself to teach dyslexic children, and is a special education in Chennai and Bala in Hemandadeyar. Son is a consultant surgeon in UK. Younger daughter and son-in-law are also medical consultants in the UK in the public health and dermatology. His education studied up to 7th at Mayavaram. Subsequently shifted to Madras and joined Sri Ramakrishna Mission Boys High School up to 11th standard. Passed SSLC with Presidency Honor in Chemistry in 1943. Fellow of Arts at Madras Christian College between 1943 and 45. Duration of profession, 60 years, worked as honorary surgeon in Government Stanley Hospital, civil assistant surgeon in Raipeta Hospital. His clients were Chavalier Shivaji Ganeshan and family, Sandu Chittapadeva and family, Pasun, Chief Minister Devanita, and comedian Tangavir. Present status, general practitioner, surgeon, honorary president and medical director at Public Health Center, with which associate for nearly 50 years in honorary capacity. Future, he believes in honorary professional work through general practice at a public health center to alleviate the suffering of patients physically. Thank you.
FRCP Glasgow, FRCP Edinburgh, academic qualifications, FRCP in 2016 Edinburgh, FRCP 2013 Glasgow, DM Nephrology 1998 Madras Medical College, MD General Medicine 1993 Stanley Medical College, MBBS 1990 Madras Medical College, merits, new young key opinion leader in renal transplantation from India 2009. International Society of Nephrology Fellowship, Renal Unit, Royal North Shore Hospital, Sydney, Australia 1997. Present appointment from September 2011. Professor and HOD of Nephrology Department, Stanley Medical College, Chennai, India. Previous appointments, Professor and HOD of Nephrology, Chengalpattu Medical College and Kilpatham Medical College, Chennai. India, October 2009 to September 2011. Assistant Professor of Nephrology, Madras Medical College, Chennai, India, March 1998 to October 2009. Postgraduate student in renal medicine, DM Nephrology, Madras Medical College, March 1996 to 1998. Tutor in Nephrology, Madras Medical College, Chennai, India, June 1995 to March 1996. Medical practitioner, Primary Health Center, Rural Tamil India, Tamil Nadu, India, September 1993 to June 1995, postgraduate student in internal medicine, MD General Medicine, Stanley Medical College, Chennai, India, September 1992, August 1993, medical graduate, MBBS, Madras Medical College, Chennai, September 1984 to January 1990. Professional memberships, Association of Physicians of India, Indian Society of Nephrology, Territorial Dialysis Society of India, Indian Society of Organ Transplantation, Nephrology, Urology, Transplant Society of SOR and Indian Medical Association. Sir, we are very proud to invite you to the great person.
I request Dr. Venkatesai to call in the speaker.
I shall be talking to you about a very common problem that all of us face, whatever may be our specialty, but we face this problem of increasing problem of obesity, and I shall be talking to you about how it is related to the I greet you warm greetings from the 82-year-old Stanley Medical College. Many of you would have been students at some point of time, teachers also here. Obesity is linked to about 53 odd diseases, starting from stroke, obstructive sleep apnea, cataracts, hypoventilation. There's huge burden on the liver, heart, pulmonary disease, diabetes, cancer, gynecoabnormalities, osteoporosis, gout, and not to forget 35 more diseases, out of which the kidney is also an important part. So over the next 15 minutes, I shall be talking to you about the prevalence of obesity, India and worldwide, and what is its association with kidney, the pathomechanisms, and how kidney diseases are treated relating to the result of obesity. This obesity trend in India, this is published in 2009 in the Japanese. We find that in adult urban India, it's increased from 1975. This is the red one is China, green one is India. So you can see how it has. In fact, it's more in women than men. So from 75 to 2014, there's almost doubling of the prevalence of obesity in our country. And this is the WHO criteria. We go by the BMI, and somebody's BMI is more than 30, we call them obesity, it's graded. Well, we have our own BMI standards for India, for obesity. And a BMI of more than 30, I mean, Asians and Indians about more than 25 is defined as obesity. This is based on large epidemiological studies done all over the country. And abdominal obesity, a waist circumference of more than 90, and in women more than 80 centimeters would constitute obesity. In the US, the prevalence of obesity is about 35 to 40%, with 5% extreme obesity. What is alarming is in children, it's about 17%. And the projected growth is something like 40% next decade. And the recent trend is that low and middle income countries also show transition from normal to overweight and obesity. Well, it's a very busy slide, but what I basically want to tell you is the increased adiposity and the adipokine synthesis, lipid production, increased activity of the sympathetic nervous system, increased activity of the renin angiotensin system, mechanical stress, all this leads through multiple pathways to affect the heart, as in congestive heart failure, stroke, coronary, chronic kidney disease, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, steatohepatosis, cirrhosis, obstructive sleep apnea, systemic and pulmonary hypertension, osteoarthrosis of the knees, and increased intra-abdominal pressure leading to esophageal reflux, Barrett's esophagus, and esophageal adenocarcinoma. So just an increase in adiposity has got a multi-pronged attack on multiple organs. We come to the kidney. Every year, the second Thursday of March is commemorated as World Kidney Day. And this year, the theme was kidney disease and obesity. So we have an entity called obesity-related glomerulopathy, that's an entity specific for obesity. The nephrolithiasis is more common in obese patients. Malignancies, particularly cancers of the kidney. Obesity has problems on the bone metabolism and also renal anemia. So basically what happens here, what is the connection between obesity and kidney disease? There is increased activation of the renin angiotensin system. The kidneys get compressed. There is increased leptin, which activates the sympathetic nervous system, causes vasoconstriction. Compression of the kidney and activation of the renin angiotensin system causes increased sodium tubular absorption, reabsorption, decrease in the pressure and arteriolysis that leads to hypertension, volume expansion, atherosclerosis. Obesity and overweight also leads to insulin resistance, glucose intolerance, and diabetes, which by itself causes proteinuria, contributing to glomerulosclerosis. And there's a role of inflammation, where these adipokines like TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, CRP, all this through multiple pathways on the metabolism cause apoptosis and fibrosis. So through inflammation, through insulin resistance, under the kidney and leptin, sympathetic nervous system, ultimately leads to chronic kidney disease. So overweight and obesity, you have environmental factors, mainly diet and decreased physical activity, genetic factors. Then you have the cardiorenal metabolic syndrome, the central obesity, insulin resistance, albuminuria, and renal function. Hyperuricemia itself is an independent cause of cardiovascular mortality as well as its effect on the kidney. Hyperfiltration injury, which leads to what is known as focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, microproteinuria as a result of endothelial dysfunction. So it has direct effects and also indirect effects. The direct effect is glomerular hyperfiltration, pro-inflammatory cytokines. It activates a cytokine called TGF-beta, which is the most fibrogenic cytokine in the body, and the altered adipokines, plus hypertension, diabetes, atherosclerosis, all this contributes to kidney disease. This is how a glomerulus would look like, find sclerosis of the glomerulus. And see, open capillary rooms, but most of the glomeruli is undergone sclerosis. This is because the kidney tries to hyperfilter, because the kidneys are made, we are born with a certain number of nephrons. We can't increase our number of nephrons. But then these nephrons have to do the work, the metabolic work, depending on our body weight, etc. So these glomeruli hyperfilter, because of hyperfiltration, they develop injury. So this is obesity-related glomerulopathy. It features proteinuria, glomerulomegaly, progressive glomerulosclerosis. Obesity induces increases in GFR, then renal plasma flow, and tubular reabsorption. So the glomerulus looks very large, and that's one of the characteristic features of obesity-related glomerulopathy. This specific entity has been described in the US, and if you find that there's a tenfold increase in the incidence of obesity-related glomerulopathy, what was 0.2% in the 90s has increased to about 2.7% between 2001 to 2015. This is a commensurate with the increase in obesity in the population. I will just skip this. Yeah, what happens in the glomerulus is there is a dilated afferent arteriole and there is impaired autoregulation and increased capillary diameter because it's trying to hypofilter. all this leads to decreased podocyte density, increased capillary wall tension, and this leads to a hemodynamic alterations in obesity, which causes an increase in the single nephron GFR, and then ultimately focal segmented glomerulosclerosis, obesity related glomerulosclerosis. These are the major adipokines and the role in CKD. We have two important adipokine. One is leptin, and other is adiponectin. This leptin is the one that causes endothelial and podocyte dysfunction, inflammation, oxidative stress, and progression of kidney disease. This is countered by adiponectin, which is anti-inflammatory, anti-atherogenic, and anti-proteinuric. So in obesity, we have a imbalance between leptin and adiponectin. So the good cytokine adiponectin is less, and the bad adipokine leptin is more. And this imbalance leads to progression of kidney disease. So basically, it is like this. Adiposity causes decrease adiponectin, increase leptin, other adipokines. All this causes insulin resistance, renin angiotensin activation, inflammation, oxidative stress, abnormal lipid metabolism, a combination of diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, liver dysfunction, and then chronic disease. And this visceral adiposity also directly contributes to the endothelial dysfunction and contributes to the tubulointerstitial fibrosis through activation of the plasminogen activator and the transforming growth factor, beta. Treating obesity definitely stabilizes chronic kidney disease. So if you have somebody, like in diabetes, you tell them to walk and reduce weight. Similarly, in chronic kidney disease also, it is mandatory that we encourage patients to lose weight. There is an increased incidence of stone disease in patients who are obese. Higher body weight is associated with a lower urinary pH, increased urinary oxalate, uric acid, sodium and phosphate excretion. And the diets richer in protein and sodium may lead to a more acidic urine, decrease in the urine citrate. And citrate is actually an agent that prevents stone formation. So here there's a decrease in urinary citrate. And all this contributes to increased incidence of nephrolithiasis in obesity patients. The leptin also inhibits the renal 1-alpha hydroxylase gene that is important in conversion of into active vitamin D and directly stimulates FGF23. And this contributes to abnormalities in the bone marrow. Patients on hemodialysis have a shortened half-life because of obesity. And obesity is associated with coronary artery disease, and this could be a major problem in patients on dialysis. What about transplant? Somebody with a BMI of more than 30 should be asked to reduce weight before transplant, because there is an increased incidence of delayed graft function if you transplant these individuals, and increased BMI is associated with more chances of acute rejection. And can an obese person donate a kidney? If the BMI is more than 40, it is definitely a contraindication to donation. And a donor with a history of prior bariatric surgery should be assessed for risk of nephrolithiasis and nephrocalcinosis, because it leads up to the CKD. And the counseling of the donor is very important before and after donation. Well, as physicians, we are also responsible for some of the problems. Orlistat is a drug that is not very widely available in the market. Orlistat causes enteric hyperoxaluria and then produces oxalate stores. So a drug used to treat obesity can contribute to kidney disease. Similarly, increased risk of nephrolithiasis, bariatric surgery, change in intestinal microbiota, decreased oxalobacter formicine. This is a bacteria that downgrades oxalate in the bowel. So if you're going to a bariatric surgery, take away a portion of the bowel, you're going to increase the oxalate levels in these patients and cause nephrolithiasis. So bariatric surgery itself, a treatment of obesity, can predispose to kidney stones, in addition to obesity itself being a risk factor for kidney stones. Slimming agents have been associated with progressive interstitial fibrosis. This is initially reported in Belgium. This was called Chinese herb nephropathy, where a particular substance, this is an agent, Aristolochia. Taking this patients who went to the slimming clinics to become slim, landed up with chronic kidney disease, and it was found that this Chinese herb nephropathy, which contains this crystallopia, was one of the reasons for causing progressive interstitial fibrosis. And well, how do you treat obesity? Best treatment is prevention, balanced low calorie diet, and physical activity, RAS blockade, continuous education, pharmacological treatment, bariatric surgery. Bariatric surgery definitely decreases albuminuria and hyperfiltration. Of course, it's associated with its own problems. Well, I'd like to conclude by looking at our work at Stanley Hospital, which needs to be updated. 760 kidney transplants over the last 15 years, out of which 115 were from deceased donors and 643 live-related donors. And as a part of all my talks, I always speak to people for organ donation. Let us all pledge our organs. In case of the eventuality, we can donate our organs, or we can even be useful to the student community for this session. The two temporals which talk about obesity, and I have just put them here. A person who eats beyond body's capacity to burn the energy will develop all kinds of diseases. So 947 and 943 temporals talk about the ancient wisdom regarding obesity. Thank you very much for your question.
Generally, we don't take up any question in our session. I request Dr. Krishnaratnam to hand over a certificate of appreciation to Dr. Edwin Fernando. I'm happy there are a lot of Stanleyans are in the crowd. Edwin scored our college. We're so proud of it. Another Stanleyan is going to give another next one.